All right. So Linda Stevens, I'm so happy to have you on again. So the third topic was prompted by chapter 10 of Burn Book by Kara Swisher, a tech love story. So I read that on the plane mostly, funnily enough, on my way back to London from San Francisco. And yeah, so in chapter 10, there were 7 pages of observations from Kara about the gradual rise of women on boards in Silicon Valley. So you factor in somehow here because you are one of the most successful women in geospatial. You also live in Silicon Valley and you have several stories to tell about your own experience getting on the board at Esri. So I, along with everyone else, would like to hear what those stories are, especially in terms of myself, to learn how to be an effective GIS team leader, as I'm confronted with the opportunity to become one. So, yeah, we'd be interested to hear about the progress that you've made civilizing the tech industry in this regard, along with others such as Ellen Powell and Sheryl Sandberg. So take it away.
Well, thank you. And it's a big subject, so we'll try to touch on as much as I can. First off, I think just you even being aware that there may be an issue is kind of the first step, and mainly the most important step, honestly. Because I don't think most of the issues with women in tech or women in any career field is purposeful, right? So I want to start off with that. I think, and I'll talk more about what that means. I think that, like in any job or any even like in any sport or anything, it's very competitive, right? In tech, it's very competitive. So moving up the ladder to the executive office is a competitive game. It's rough and tumbled. It's all of those things. And so, the people are going to try to figure out what the coach is looking for, or in this case, the CEO was looking for, and then try to kind of figure out how they fit into that and move up that path. At the same time, there's a lot of people trying to tackle you and get rid of your competition, right? And one of the things that that's going on is, if you can get rid of women as a competitive group in anything, that's half of the population. And so there's a lot of that going on. And I don't think it's, like I said, I don't think it's purposeful. I think it's like, let's read the tea leaves. Let's read the what the owner or the person is that wants us, what they want, and then let's do that. And also in that vein, and you and I have talked about this, women, there's two kinds of energies in all of us. There's the masculine and the feminine energy. We have both. But what I've noticed as I look back on my career is that I've really nurtured and grown that masculine energy in me, right? Because you have to, I would say you still have to, even more than ever, especially in the tech industry, you have to play the game like the men play the game. And honestly, it's cutthroat. And it gets harder and harder as you move up. But actually, one of the hardest things is to stay in the game, right? And as you get older, you're like, wait, I don't necessarily want to play this game anymore. And I think that's the biggest danger for tech companies and boards is they lose one of their most valuable assets, which is that diversity, that thinking that women bring. Because after a while, women are like, this is a joke, right? It's not fun, it's not productive, and it's not good for the company or the clients or society in general. So in my career path, when I started at Esri, it was about 100 people. It was tiny. Everybody, there was a handful of people that worked directly for Jack, and that's kind of what we might call the directors. But it was really everybody did everything, And one of Jack's wonderful qualities is he never would mind just jumping in and doing the work, right? So in some of the early days when we were setting up booths, it's like Jack would go and empty the trash, or he would go buy me coffee if I was doing a demo, and he's like, oh, I'll go get you a cup of coffee. He would, right? He doesn't have that kind of that he has a sense of equity deep inside him. He really does. So I want to also say that. But when I started at Esri, I was basically the only woman. There was maybe two other women in the professional side of the GIS side of it, I should say, the front office side. And I came in as a programmer. I came in as a geographer, and I came in, you know, from I was very passionate and driven, and I wasn't afraid to sort of step up and demand what I thought I deserved from my work. So I started off just doing what we called benchmarks in those days. I don't know if you're familiar with what a benchmark is. Nope. Okay. A benchmark, and they don't do that anymore. I don't know if they do them anymore, but we used to get these big documents, and they used to have in there, all of these questions like an RFP, but they also included a list of things you had to come out and show them. And they gave you data with it, and they gave you this long list of things that, you know, were hard. I mean, you know, this is in the days of prime computers when I started, and then workstations. So you're talking about, and there was all command lines. So we're talking about like I was in charge of the Hong Kong lands benchmark, Singapore, where we won that. Esri's still doing great there. Greek Navy, all of the utilities, I was in charge of that. And in those days, you know, ArcGIS didn't do any network tracing, like upstream, downstream, open and closing switches, cold loads, pickups, all that stuff. I had to code that, right? I coded that in AMLs and using unique new data models that we just created. There was a team of us. There was like three of us. But it was, you know, so in those days, we were going after, you know, environmental company. But then we started, and I did a lot of this with data-driven cartography. So remember, GIS came from, we got to put these maps in the computer and then print out paper maps, right? Because the workflows of everybody in the world was still was based on paper maps. So we had to create these maps, and they wanted to be exactly like the paper maps. That's part of the thing, right? So in Hong Kong, I remember going over there with reel-to-reel tapes, because I had to do this big library query, and we were in the middle of the prime headquarters in Hong Kong, surrounded it. It was just crazy. We had to do these, you know, they give me a question like, do this query with XYZ's weird things, and up would pop a pattern from this map library. And if it was correct, they would clap, right? So I felt like it was like a GRE test in the United States. It was like it was crazy. Anyway, so I did that for when I first got there for 10 years. I don't know. I was doing that as well as doing marketing after a while. And so I had the credibility, right? Like I was driving innovation, prototyping, creating new markets, programmer. We used to call ourselves we were ninjas, GIS ninjas, right? And people, so I had that credibility. So I kind of at some point had a choice. Should I stay in the programming side or not? And in 2 seconds after meeting Scott Morehouse, there's no way in heck I would join that group, right? It's the development group is male dominated at Esri, probably everywhere. Very nasty. It just was not a good place. And plus, you know, I wanted to do cool, innovative work, not, you know, write documentation, which is where most women get sort of pushed into. Like women do documentation, men do coding. So I started focusing just on the electric and gas market, created that industry, got on the board of AMFM, we renamed it JITA. And then as we started to grow, it's like we need a marketing group, right? And so I was asked to do that. Now that's the first thing that sort of, well, let me go back a second. When I went to Hong Kong, I sat in the room and everybody, when I got there, there was a guy named Tony Lupien. He was the head of network program, and he's passed away since then, but he came with me because they didn't want me to go alone. I hadn't slept in weeks. So he came with me, and they looked at him and like, okay, can you tell us how you did this? Because I did something that was so incredibly difficult to do that none of the other vendors had done it. And Tony looks at him and goes, I have no idea. You need to ask her, right? So like, that's very common. And after that, they were like my biggest fan. Like they were wonderful. But then as I came back and I started to do this, and utility market's very male dominated, but you know, you work through it, because if you're the only one in the room that can answer their questions, then you sort of get the respect. But then I was asked to create the marketing division. And so as I was organizing that, and there's, you know, there was probably, I don't know, five directors, and there's this director meeting, and I wasn't invited to it. So I called Jack up and I said, I don't want to do this. Like, I'll go back to doing flying around the world, talking to utilities. What the heck? And he said, well, you know, okay, let me think about it. And then he called me back and later and said, okay, that you can come to the meeting, the director meeting. And so the reason that's important is because previous to that, before I had been asked to officially be it, they had sent this guy who was a nice guy, but he was like the head of facility. Like, he was the operations guy. He came back from the first meeting that I hadn't officially been a director, and came back and told me, here's the five markets you need to go after. And I'm like, what? Like, okay, why? That makes no sense. Why this? I know the technology. And he's just looking at me like, I don't know. I'm in charge of facilities, right? Like, I don't know about that. So I'm like, well, how am I supposed to do my job, right, if I can't be at the table? And so I decided when Jack called me, and I said, well, if I can't be at the table, then I can't do my job, right? And so I then started coming to the directors' meetings, and oh my God, what a nightmare. But it was a nightmare in some ways, because it was all men, everybody, you know. Jack has a management style of pitting directors against each other. It's kind of wheel and spoke. He wants to be the center and everything has to go through him, especially when we were small. And by the way, that's okay. I mean, that's his style. But what was very not healthy was he would pit directors against, like, if he didn't like what Scott was doing, he would pit Scott against me, or Dave McGuire against me, right? Or Clint, right? Or Clint against Scott, or, but it was like this crazy thing. I mean, it was really unhealthy, I should say. There's people that I know that were in very deep psychological trauma, one of the couple men, some of those directors' meetings. It was really bad. So, you know, I held my own. Trust me, they all know I held my own for many years. And but there's so many things that came out of those meetings that would have been different if there hadn't been a woman there. But it's not just the woman, it's being the marketing director has to be at that meeting. If you don't have a marketing CMO who deeply understands your product, deeply understands the company, deeply understands the mission, then you're not going to be successful. You're just not. And so I, in those meetings, you know, so coming back to the woman side of it, there's a lot of reasons why marketing needs to be there, so I won't talk about that. But one of the reasons women needs to be there, and I'll give you just one really obvious example. They decided they were going to build a fitness studio on campus, right?
I can just imagine what you're about to say.
Right. And they built, and of course they didn't get very, they, you know, for workout equipment, and they're going to have a little shower, you know, a place where you can dress and change. It was only going to be for men. Seriously. And I'm this whole conversation's going on, and I'm like, and I'm a cycle. Those days I was cycling a lot, and I didn't cycle at work, but I'm a cyclist, right? And I know a lot of my women friends were cycling. Don't you know? They take their break on a beautiful day in Redlands. It's like, oh, you can't. How can you not? And so it would be great. They could cycle, not have to go home. You know, they could just go and shower. And somebody asked me, and I won't tell you. So it's like, well, women would never want to work out and take a shower at work. I'm like, yes, they would. And then one of the guys, see, I'm not naming names, raises his hand. Well, we can just have a shared showering area. Like, dude, like, no, and I know you, like, no way. So they did not do the men only or joint shower thing. So by the way, I think it never occurred to them to think about, it's not like, you know, I think after I made my position clear, you know, most of them went, oh, yeah, 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 we need to have, right? But it wouldn't have even been brought up. And it would have, it might have been fixed later. And those are tons of those kinds of examples, right? But there's a lot. So those are kind of, you can laugh. You know, it's kind of ridiculous. But there's deeper, deeper, deeper ones, right? So this is something for you to think about, especially as people move up and or they start their own companies. Because I'll give you an example of how this bias against women and people of color, I'm going to say, affects company deeply. So as I was growing my organization, I would be interviewing candidates for different positions, right? And as if the position was more senior or if it was in sort of that tech field or whatever, my team would interview them, HR first, then me, and it would go up to Jack or the other owner that is his wife. And so I would get back replies to candidates I sent up there that were things like, why isn't she married? You know?
When was this?
Like, huh?
When was this? What year? Or roughly?
No, it was
decade?
The whole time. But I'm going to tell really? You why. Oh, for sure. And it's like, they never asked me of a man that at all. Mm-hmm. So it's also, you know, is she going to have kids? Things like, I don't like her eyes. Like, what? And then you started just noticing there would just be no's to certain, you started to, so I'm, how do I, this is where this gets to be ingrained in the DNA of a company. Because then HR, right, is getting in trouble for sending candidates up that aren't being approved. I don't hear back why they're not approved, because they're not going to tell me something that's illegal, because it is. So all of a sudden, HR then is like, even if it's not obvious, they're starting to screen even the resumes that come to me that might not get approved by corporate, right? And I'll give another example, right? There was a beautiful, wonderful woman who we were interviewing for a proposal manager, and she was African-American, really nice lady. I wasn't in my team, but I was called in to a joint interview with one of the owners. And the question that was asked of me while I was sitting there with her is, you know, because I grew up in Redlands. Well, would a Black woman be happy living in Redlands? And I'm like, what? Like, what? And then things like, you know, Do you have any Black people that work in your group, Linda? Like, it was the weirdest conversation I've ever had, right? Didn't get hired. And so after a while, it becomes embedded, right? So you start to see resumes getting screened before you see them. Does that make sense, right?
Yeah.
So it's not like you can say they're everybody's biased. It's just you start to say, oh, I get in trouble because 30% of my candidates get a no from corporate, and I get in trouble as an HR rep because, you know, I'm being judged at the end of the year for my I'm a recruiter. So you're going to start looking for candidates that will please them. So then you start, right? Do you see what I'm saying? You have to be really careful because some of those biases aren't, you might not even know you have them, right? You might interview a candidate and go, and I would get that a lot. I just don't like them. I don't have a good feel about them, or I don't like their eyes, or whatever it is. And so you see that as it moved up, that in a lot of cases it was easier and better for me to promote within because I ended up not even thinking about half and half women for department managers, my direct reports. But you had to sort of, it was like this game. How am I going to get this beautiful mixture around sort of this embedded bias against women? And so I think that that's something that most businesses or people don't even know they have. We all have them, right? We have them about, you know, we're more comfortable with people that are similar to us because we understand when they talk to us, we can understand their references or their whatever, right? But you have to dig deeper. Because
and their jokes.
And they're jokes, right? And even there, when they make metaphors and stuff, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm getting at.
Yeah, yeah. And so you...
The code.
And I can tell you, when I jumping back to being at the director level at Esri, it was all man talk, right? They would forget I was there, right? And, oh my God, the code, whatever, that was not healthy. It wasn't healthy for them because they were all bad, you know, it's a competition and it was all, and I think Esri has always suffered from that, honestly, is the lack of diversity, not just in women-men balance, but in diversity of race, but also economic background, in degrees, right? Like what field you're coming from. It's something that, they should shift some really blatant, obvious bad policies. Like when the federal government, you know, they got fined for paying women less. And that's another example of how that happens, right? So the way raises work at Esri, or they did, is that the raise amount was filtered through me. I would approve it. And then I would sit with Jack for the exempt. We were paid by the hour, by the way, exempt and non-exempt. And in those meetings, things would come up like, well, I want to give him more because he has a family. Right. He's the breadwinner. And you're like, what? Like I had plenty of single women who were way more productive. Right. And so, you know, I think, you know, you're trying to do something you think is right for some guy, you know, and versus trying to look at it from a fairness perspective, because you don't know anything about other. You shouldn't know everything about people's lives. Right. And that's not people don't get paid for the number of, you know, kids they have. So I think that's, you know, some of that's because of the, you know, that's a generational thing. It was more common. But I think that you can see that in everything in the tech. And so up here, you see the same thing, right? It's very, in the geospatial community, you know, it's very hard to find women who are at the same leadership level in these companies or in these boards or speaking out on social media or whatever. I'd like to say
I've been challenging that a little bit on my little podcast. I've had a whole string of women, Russia, Kazakhstan, yourself. I'm talking to Stephanie May, I think, from Stamen, as a potential next guest.
So. That's awesome. That's awesome. 'Cause they're out there and they're wonderful. Right. And, you know, it's, they just bring a fresh and different perspective. I'm not saying better or worse or anything. It's just different. And again, if we go back to this, this balance, right, it's out of balance. I'm not saying, you know, we need both that it's out of balance, not only in the male female, but also in the male and female energy, right? It's that, how do we combine that aggressive sort of, I want to, you know, beat everybody and take control of the market and the make tons of money against, oh, I want to create a nurturing environment where people can discover their and create their best work, right? How do we empower people, our customers, to achieve their dreams and what they want to do? And how can our software and our company help them do that? That's a much different combination than the sort of that male energy of how can I make the next deal and bring and pull more money out of my customers, right? That constant flow of how can we grow, you know, another 20% is way different than, and by the way, with that combination of helping and supporting your customers and your staff and your partners, can't forget partners because those people need to be nurtured too, actually helps you make that 20% growth, but in a better, more balanced, more holistic way. And
less extractive.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
You're not strip mining a natural resource.
Right. And people aren't furniture. You know, they're not assets. They're people. They're not the same thing as a chair or a printer or a Xerox machine, right? they're people that have lives. They're contributing to the world. They're contributing to your company, and their whole life is spent at your company. Like, make it a great part of their life, not something they, you know, that they regret or that they are, you know, burnt out from.
I remember when we were, setting up this conversation last week, you used a wonderful phrase, doing your life's work.
Yes, right? Isn't that what we want to do as managers, as leaders, as company owners, as organization leaders, is create an environment where people can do their best work. And yes, the shareholders and the directors or whatever, they make money off of that great work. So don't you want it to be as great as it can?
Like, hell yeah.
The people that make all this money, they're not doing the work. They're doing a piece of it, right? But they're not, you know, if Steve Jobs had nobody working for him, there wouldn't be an iPhone. Come on, right? And without great workers and great staff, there, you know, the leader doesn't have anything to lead. And so,
and that fundamental one there.
It's fundamental. And that needs to be, so let's go back to the beginning, right? And everything needs to be in balance, right? The planet needs to be in balance. Our environment needs to balance. Our companies need to be in balance. And so if we look at, for example, since we last talked, you know, Kamala Harris is now our nominee for President of the United States.
We choose freedom.
Put this book up again because somehow it seems relevant.
It is. And she was my senator. I'm from California. So I know Kamala Harris's background. Oh my gosh. Not many people can compete with it. But, you know, I had a conversation with a nice woman who's a Democrat, who's always been a Democrat. And she said to me, well, you know, I'm worried about her experience. And I said, well, she was a senator. And he's like, no, she wasn't. And she's from California. Like, I think she got appointed. I know, like, nope, that was the last person. So she was questioning her capabilities. And then, I'm like, no. And when I shared that with her, it just hit me that, you know, everybody, even women, can be some of the most unaware of their biases against women. And so we have to do everything stronger, better, more. And I told her, I said, you know, Obama had way less experience than Kamala Harris has right now. And it's like, what? Like, he had no experience. He was only a senator briefly. She's done so much more. And that's not against Obama. I'm just saying that women have to somehow, you know, be twice as good, 10 times as more. And when you start to, you know, you're in the United States right now and on a lot of social media and all that, you're going to start to hear the things that I've heard my whole life, right? Like, you know, okay, when I'm pushy, I'm a bitch, I'm too aggressive, I'm mean. Men are the, you know, oh my God, he's a warrior. He's, you know.
Yes.
Oh my
God. Rewarded for toughness.
He's rewarded for toughness, and we are smacked down. And so going back to my journey, if I hadn't had that credibility, and if I hadn't demanded and said, I'm not doing this if you don't give me the responsibility and the ability to do this job, you know, then I would have been sitting there in the corner, and it would have been awful because I wouldn't have been able to do my job. And so I think that's a lesson. I mean, right now is a great opportunity for everybody to see, but women see, it's right out in the open in America right now of how women are treated. And, you know,
isn't Trump a great contrast in this context? Because he's the polar opposite.
And even it's not even age, Vance is the same way, right? Women who don't have children shouldn't be allowed to vote because they don't have any. What?
He said that.
He did, because we don't have any stake in the future. I'm like, I have three stepkids. Like, what? I don't even. It's just crazy, right? And people are going, this is crazy, but you don't understand that. This is not unusual, especially as you get into a very competitive environment. They try. So it's like, how do we degrade my competition, right? How do I stand out from my competition. Well, I say stand out on your merit, stand out on your work. Don't stand out on personal attacks. And, you know, I'm also standing up for, you know, there's MAGA. Do you know what MAGA is? It's sure. Republican
Unfortunately,
women.
Unfortunately, we do.
Yeah. I lived in a very red area. I lived in Chico, which is almost on fire right now, up in Northern California. And I lived in Forest Hill, which are very, very deep, deep, deep red territory. I mean, people with big signs in their trucks. And so I know these people, and they're kind. They're very community oriented. We were stuck in the snowstorm a couple years ago, and everything was down. Power was down. The roads were stuck. And you would have people knocking on your door going, do you need help? I have a chainsaw. Do you need food? People are reaching out, right? They're not horrible people. They just are ill-informed, right? But, you know, what I also see is people taking, you know, people making personal attacks on these. There was some women on a CNN panel, and they're talking about their weight or how dumb, and like, da-da. I'm like, stop it, right? That's not good for anybody to ever do.
So it's both sides of the gender divide that aren't anticipating female leadership.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you know, I think in a lot of these red areas, it's very male.
Especially there, perhaps.
Yeah, very male dominated. They're very much suppressed. If you talk to them outside of their when their husbands aren't around and stuff, they're much more relaxed and much more open up, and they talk to. I never talk politics with them. That wasn't my place. But I, you know, they were much more open, much more willing to listen, much more caring and loving. I mean, they love their family, they love their children, right? Like we all do. But they, and you know, in the United States, a lot of these folks listen to local talk radio where they're talking about what tractor to buy, you know, or what's the crop going to be, and their minister comes on, and then they talk about politics. It's just woven all through it, right? And, you know, people in the cities don't know all of this, right? And so, you know, it's an educational thing, right? And a lot of these people it's all white. There's no people of color.
Right.
In a lot of these places in the United States. And so, you know, the only way they know of other cultures is from television and from the news and what people tell them. So my point is, you know, on the political side is you need to reach out. We need to reach out and talk to these people, you know, and be friends with them. And yeah. They might have some crazy views, but they think our views are crazy too, right? So,
sure.
But go ahead.
I've got a cheeky quip. Maybe Carmela needs to drive a tractor.
Oh, maybe she could.
I think people would love that.
Yeah. Well, and I think it's about it applies to work. So you know. It's great when everybody sits around the table and everybody's agreeing with you, right? Oh, right. You know, and they're all looking at each other. Everybody tries to agree. So if we go back to Esri, you know, whatever Jack says, right? Whatever. But you don't, that doesn't do any good for him. It doesn't do anything good for the company, right? Somebody needs to raise their hand and go, okay, wait, but I don't think this works. Or I can tell you, I've raised my hand a lot of times, and sometimes I was completely wrong. And sometimes I was completely right. Sometimes I was in the middle. Sometimes he agreed with me. Sometimes I didn't. But I was always, I always made my point. And, you know, because here's another thing you have to watch out for is a lot of companies, and Esri is really, I think, well known for this, is passive aggressive, very passive aggressive. So, you know, when you know, if you're in a debate about something, let's say like, I don't know, you know, when should we release this product or whatever? Should this feature be in it? Or what do we do because there's this big bug and it's hurting people's data? How are we going to deal with that? You can have those debates. But when it's all done in a passive-aggressive way, you can't face those attacks, right? Because they're not a direct-on attack. And those are a lot harder to deal with. And I think women just are not as I don't know. I don't think they're as aware of some of those things, right? They're like, oh, that person didn't really mean that. And I'm like, oh, yeah, they did. Just watch. I can tell you what's going to happen. Exactly, right? So the passive aggressive side is very dangerous. And it's something to watch out for as a manager, because you want issues and controversies or disagreements to be surfaced and brought on the table so they can be dealt with. And then you move on. And they shouldn't be personal. This is just business.
I think it makes it particularly difficult to create a situation where people can have a face-to-face disagreement if there's a undertone of it being personal. So to me, perhaps an activity or a function of a good leader is to create an atmosphere in a team where there's a tradition of disagreements occurring without them being personal, but you know, maybe that's an impossible thing to achieve fully.
No, it should never be. It's not. It shouldn't be impossible. We should never attack people personally. And you know, here's a passive aggressive thing that happens all the time. Well, I don't like Linda, so I'm not going to invite her to the meeting where we discuss about when we talk about messaging. So Linda finds out and just shows up, right?
Right.
But, you know, a lot of people wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
And okay. So you have to be on point. You have to know what's going on in the ecosystem of your organization to find out where are all the little, what's popping up and all that.
So the impression, there's a theme that I'm noticing here. It, from the outset, when you were describing the beginning of your career, when Ezra was small, you said that you asserted yourself and demanded based on, and I guess you had confidence in your technical, your track record of technical delivery, perhaps especially because of that and also because of your personality, perhaps. You had the muscle, if I can put it that way, to push yourself in front of the CEO and get the audience that you deserve to, in your view, execute in that new role as the marketing lead or the chief marketing officer. I don't know if that's what you were at the time, but I just want to say, it seems like you have a quality that means that you can push through barriers that perhaps others wouldn't have had the confidence to do. And then you just said that you found out at one point that people were talking behind your back or wanting to arrange an important meeting to you without inviting you. You found out and you turned up, and you mentioned that others may not have had the courage to do that. So I guess I see through that why you've achieved what you have achieved. Are we at a point where someone who is uniquely assertive, who is a woman, is where it's not, where we no longer need someone uniquely assertive to ascend?
I don't think anything's changed.
I see.
And I'll say it wasn't just one meeting. This happened all the time.
Sure.
I showed up. But it's also, this is what I used to advise women, right? So, if you start looking for it, you'll see it everywhere, right? I would see women who are very strong, very powerful, but when they left the room, especially if they were attractive, all the men would be talking about, oh, I want to go on a date with her and da-da-da. And her boss would introduce her sometimes at, this is one example, but this happened many times. Here's so-and-so, isn't she beautiful, right? And you're like, but would he introduce his other, like, oh, here's Bob and isn't he handsome? Like, no, right? Those little, they think they're
sexual objectification.
Yeah, and think they're giving you a compliment. And if you notice in some of like Discord or Reddit or whatever comments from the user conference, Jack will do that on stage. You'll see some comments where he makes these little statements that are just awkward, they're not, and it's not him. I'm just saying people say that kind of stuff. They think they're being kind and being complimentary, but all of a sudden the person that woman is being introduced to, they now see her as an object. They're starting to think about, oh, she is beautiful. Oh, I know, you know.
And so your point, unfortunately, is that this still happens. You still need to be uniquely assertive.
Yeah,
women are still being sexually objectified by the leader of the dominant company in the industry. I'm sorry to be so straightforward. unfortunately, not enough progress has happened.
Yeah, and I don't want to step, because I don't think Jack means that. And some of that's his generation, but I'm saying this about other. So I have pulled men aside and said, stop introducing her like that. This was somebody I was a partner I was working with doing work, and he was doing this to one of his staff members who was great. And I'm like, stop doing that. Like, stop introducing her like that. You know, she's a salt, you know, and he hadn't even noticed it. Right. So again, some of these things are very, very, very subtle. So how I coach women is, one, don't accept that kind of conversation. If you keep being introduced like that, pull them aside and say, can you not introduce me to like that? Right. Two, women have to then pull. So women also can't be unbalanced. So men are very balanced on that male energy, aggressive energy, masculine energy. They need to have more of that feminine energy, like going, okay, being empathetic, being compassionate, going, oh, maybe I shouldn't say this about this person, right? I'm at work. I shouldn't be making this comment about her. And women need to be more aggressive. Don't accept not being invited to a meeting. Don't sit and pout. Like, don't, you know, just show up. It's your responsibility for that piece of what they're talking about. Show up. And I've never been told not to come into a meeting if I should have been there. Ever, right? And Jack had my back. I'm going to also say that. Like, Jack is the one that said, yes, you're going to be in this meeting, and yes, you should be in this thing. But I'll give you another example where this stuff happens all the time. And I think I wrote about this on LinkedIn. My first time as a director at the user conference, at the end, they have that closing panel and everybody sits in all the directors. In those days, there was, I don't know, five of us or whatever that would sit at the table. So I'm marching in to sit at the table. I don't have a name placard. There's no chair for me. I'm like, what? And it's like, well, you know, some of the directors decided I was a little D director, that I shouldn't be on the panel because I was, I guess, a woman. I don't know. They just said I was a little D versus a big D director. And I'm like, okay, really? Like,
so I have
let me
to
talk
ask...
to Jack before I call my lawyer. Like, what? Sure.
So what were the other directors? And also, I think maybe for myself and others that are listening who may not know actually what a board of directors is, what the hell is one? And is a director?
So Esri's not like a normal company. So it wasn't a board of directors. At Esri, you can think of it as the executive suite. It's the people that basically work directly for Jack or his wife. So there, you know, the head of development, the head of product, the head of product management, kind of, that came later, marketing, sales, even though I think sales came later and now it's like multiple people, operations, that's more the back office, finance might be there at the director meeting. The finance and the op person might not be at the panel at the user conference, but it's the people that directly worked for the owners. And we had, I think, meetings twice a year that were 2-day meetings. And then we would often, and then the directors who were not back office, front office, which, you know, sales, marketing, product, we would review all the software development twice a year to figure out what they were doing and then give them direction on which way to go. And then we had to figure out how to market, sell it, price it.
So the main people that work directly for them.
And we would have divisions. I think now they're naming everybody director, so it's confusing, but it's the people that are corporate man. We had the big corporate teams.
Gotcha. Yeah. Okay. All right.
But board of directors are different. There's a lot more legal responsibility. If you're a board, I was a board of a director of a couple of nonprofits, and it has different meaning than the one at Esri.
Okay, I got another question here. Mm-hmm. So you've mentioned a couple of times that Jack's wife was involved in hiring decisions. It seems that she, as a woman, had some sort of leadership function at Esri. If you're comfortable, I mean, I'm interested in the context of you speaking about your experience as a woman at Esri, what sort of role and power she had?
She had power of the purse. But she, like, in meetings, she wouldn't sit at the table with us. She'd sit in the back and, like, look at us. And she, she in the early days, she wasn't really around much. I think she lived in Laguna Beach or something. I don't want to talk a lot about her. It's a very unhealthy thing. And I think that, but it's a good example of where this isn't just a male problem, right? Some women are also not comfortable with women that are powerful. And you can see this a little bit with, you know, it's not just men that are taking shots at Kamala Harris, right? You know, and so I'm just going to leave it there.
No problem.
Yeah.
Okay. So there's been something in the back of my mind to say as sort of the man in this discussion. So I appreciated your points about the male energy, the go-get-it, aggressive, what can I say, dominate a territory sort of approach.
Yeah.
But what comes with that also is vulnerability being stigmatized. And I wanted to tie this to you making the comment again early on that you felt like you had to adopt a more male stance. And I can't help but wonder if that means you toned down the vulnerability, or I just wanted you to speak to this concept.
But I also have to say, you know, as you were saying, that you also have to be aware of the men in your organization who aren't aggressive, but are brilliant, and make sure you find a safe place for them and help them realize their life's work, right? And this where it gets tricky is some of those people you want to put into a position, but if they have to get in front of these male, they'll get eaten alive, right? So I spent, and most of the people in my organization, at least at a higher level, especially the industry managers, knew how I spent a lot of time protecting them from attack. Just from because everybody wanted to attack those guys and so you know they could hold their own, but that's not what I hired them for. I hired them to be out there opening up markets and driving all the stuff. So you know you also have to be aware that you need this mixture and putting people in the right place. If you put somebody in a place that's not doesn't fit their style, then it's also harmful for them. It really hurts people to be attacked at work, right? You're vulnerable. It's what you find pride in. You find pride in your work, right? So there's that kind of thing, right? And there's just people that are bullies, you know, don't create a bullying environment is all I'm going to say. It's not a healthy environment, but I don't think I answered your question. I went off on a tangent.
It's okay. I can perhaps make my point in a more provocative way.
Okay.
I'm going to speak from personal experience, and it's a cross-cultural example.
Yeah.
So I did my master's at the University of Melbourne. Funnily enough, for some reason, I'm wearing that as my hoodie today. It wasn't by design.
Sure.
So there's a strong difference between Australian male culture and the culture of many of the students from Southeast Asia that I did my master's with. There were guys from Malaysia, Vietnam, Cambodia, China. And there was this tutorial room called the Green Room, which we all slaved away in doing all of our assignments. Anyway, so there was this moment of intense discomfort for me at one point, because I forget which one it was. I think it might have been the guy from Malaysia. He just casually came over and started massaging my shoulders. And you would not have believed how much I jumped out of my skin when he did that. Because that is like,
yes.
Men can't touch each other.
Right.
Where I'm from.
Right.
I perceive from my reading of American culture, it's similar. Because male on male touch is homosexual in our culture. Whereas in the culture where a lot of my fellow students came from, it's not. It's just nurturing. It's fine. You can show a bit of goddamn affection to each other and be supportive. And it's a good thing.
Yes, it is.
But that is not a characteristic of the more cutthroat dominance and bullying-based culture that I perceive the Western milieu to be. And I guess that's what I was trying to say about vulnerability, that in fact, I believe it to be an incredibly effective way to show strength, to be vulnerable. And I'm just wondering if we are missing something as a culture that relates to the points you're making about the interplay between men and women.
Yes, it is. It's difficult for anybody to be vulnerable. And I think you become vulnerable when you do something that you're not sure everybody in the room would agree with. So yeah, it's massaging, you know, giving that, it's giving somebody a hug. Oh my God, there would be no way at Ezra.
Oh my God, what I just say brings up a whole bunch of issues about unwanted touch between men and women. And of course, I'm trying to talk about the unique lack of vulnerability between men in Western culture.
Here's the difference. I'm gonna give you an explanation of the difference. So there's lots, because you can imagine I had 300 people working for me, and there was sexual harassment that came up. In one case, it was somebody I'd known since high school who she was driving back from downtown, and got in the car with her. She was giving him a ride, and basically he stopped the car as he was driving her somewhere, like to drop her off somewhere, and basically said, and he's married, I want to, you know, I think we should go out on a date. I think you're really beautiful. And wouldn't let her get out of the car, right? We, in those days, you know, HR said, don't do that again, right? And so it was like a slap on the wrist, right? That's unwanted, that aggressive, you can't get out of the situation, you feel trapped. It's not the fact that he found her attractive, like, okay, just say, whatever. It's when you feel like you can't, you have no power, and you feel like you're in danger. And that happens too often to not just women, but it just tends to be that way because men are more aggressive and women, you know, can be afraid of them for that reason.
So there's some physical vulnerability there that women perhaps have. I don't know. It's a tough topic to get into. And I feel like, sorry, you go.
Well, let me just say, the thing about vulnerability is that you have to realize, you know, when you feel uncomfortable, the first thing to say is, do I really have a reason to feel uncomfortable? Right? Am I taking this out of context? You know, like for you, right? You're uncomfortable, but if you thought about it, you're like, it's just because it's a cultural weird thing for me culturally. It's not that there's anything wrong with it, right? And women can overreact. Men can overreact, right? It's like, oh my God, he didn't mean that. Calm down. Like he's just goofy. He just doesn't know what he just took it out of context. But the reason vulnerability is important is because when you make a statement, when you challenge somebody, you're making yourself vulnerable, right? I was vulnerable when I told Jack I didn't want to be the director, because he could have just said, okay, right? Or I'm at, you know, I'm asking you to do this as a favor to me, whatever, right? He could have done a lot of different things for me to that, in that regard. So you have to be able to, you have to take risks. Let's put it that way. You have to take
risks. There is a risk. I mean,
it's not about being comfortable all the time.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah. I just wanted to say, like, about this, I think I'll need to sign the contract by tomorrow. So about this leadership position that I am considering taking on.
Yeah.
So there will be plenty of experiences that I'm going to have where I'm not going to know what to do.
Right.
I'm going to be vulnerable, and I'm going to have to admit that to my team. And I'm going to have to give up the mantle of the subject matter expert and retain my role as a leader and find someone else who's an SME who can kill it with that problem. Yeah. But to do that, I need to be able to show vulnerability and admit to people that I can't technically do everything.
Yeah.
And I think a way to show great weakness as a leader in that context is to hide my vulnerability and to pretend. Yeah. So that's what I was trying to get at.
They'll know you're pretending.
Yeah. And to admit vulnerability, to admit not knowing something, shows that you're confident enough to confess that, because you know how many other things you know and what else you can do. It's to say, you know, I'm not a complete, total, you know, badass about everything. But because...
None of us are.
Exactly.
Well, and you're going to find it's easier to admit you don't know something on a technical matter than you're going to find that you're to admit it on a personnel issue. So the hardest thing about being a manager is making the is dealing with the non-work per, like, you know, deciding if I should, you know, who should be on this team or that team, but the stuff that goes on between people, like who should you give raises to, who do you promote, who should you make team lead, who should you, because that turns into, that's all personal. It touches their very core, it touches people's core of their, who they think they are. And
they can
their,
take it personally.
To take it personally. Now, if you say, I don't know how, you know, how that works in QGIS, I don't, you know, I can you guys look that up? I can't just, I don't know if we should use, can you come back with a recommendation? They'll be like, yay, right? Like, you won't feel as vulnerable not knowing something technically than you will about not knowing how to deal with the manager problem. And you get, and you'll get from the bottom up people who will be like, oh, she's not a strong manager because she can't make this decision, especially if you're not making the decision in their favor. So.
Sure.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. All right. So.
And that's in some ways why women are better managers. The women, the feminine side, because they know they're much more empathetic. They're much, they're just, it's, and I'm not saying, I'm just saying that feminine energy, that compassion, that empathy in us has to be nurtured and grown. And you have to feel confident. It's a skill. It's just like being aggressive, right? There's, and you start to use the stuff you use, it's like a muscle, right? Muscle memory. You're gonna rely on the stuff that you've done before over and over again. And if you stop, you, if you haven't been using your compassion, empathy, team building, that sort of, that feminine side of our, of, that we all have, then you stop using it, it gets weak. And so my only point is a lot of times you'll find that women, like, you know, and who you go ask for advice, right? You'll just find you get better advice from certain people versus other based on where they have their strengths on these two kinds. And and when I say male and female energy, again, we all have both. So I'm not saying it from the, you know, male.
I mean, so maybe I don't want to beat this topic to death.
Okay.
But my last sort of comment, I suppose, what a stereotypical man confronted with the role that he has been taught he must occupy.
Yeah.
How that kind of a man, an innocent man, who's doing his best to live up to what has been put in front of him, yeah? He might perceive me saying, you've got to be okay with being vulnerable. He may perceive that as me saying, you've got to be weak. He will then interpret that as reducing his capacity to win territory in all of its metaphorical meanings that has for a man. Yeah. So what I'm trying to get at, I guess, is that I think there can be a different interpretation of the word vulnerability than weakness.
Oh, yes.
I think there can be an interpretation of it as, in a more holistic sense, strength. And I wanted to have that as my contribution to this idea of how to balance the workplace between men and women so that everyone can feel safe enough to commit to do their life's work. And you get an organization that flowers, you are tending a forest, not strip mining a natural resource, if I can overdo a analogy that came up before.
Yeah. And I think, you know, vulnerability has a negative, but it's really about, you know, accepting risk or standing, you know, making your opinion known, making your case. And so it's just, again, we use different words, but they often will be applied to the same behavior.
Mm.
Right. So I'm willing to take a risk by confronting you as my manager and saying, look, I don't really think that this is the right decision. And here's why. That's risky for me, but you can also look at it like, you know, I'm vulnerable. I'm, you know, being vulnerable to attack.
And there's strength there too, because you're not hiding something. You're not hiding something about yourself if you are taking the risk of speaking an honest opinion. Yeah. Okay. If I can, you know, if that's an effective summary.
I get what you're saying. And it's hard because it's hard, you know, people are complex. The world is complex, right? Life is complex. And you know, people, you'll hear a lot of people today, I've talked to some of my some colleagues that are still at Esri complaining about Gen Z people, right? They don't want to work hard. You know, they, you know, this and that and that. And it's like, when I look at it, I can see where they're coming from, knowing the Esri culture, but it's also like, I think Gen Z people are coming in with more empathy. They're coming from a different place than Gen Xers and baby boomers, where it was very clear, baby boomers and to a large extent Gen Xers, it was very male dominated, right? Mm-hmm. And you're still seeing this, right?
Mm-hmm.
Our roles were much more defined when I was growing up. What a woman did, what a man did, what children did, they were defined very clearly. I pushed those boundaries, right? But I think those boundaries are less clear for, to some extent, the millennials, but also Gen Zs.
And that's kind of getting to my point that then perhaps we don't need a uniquely assertive person anymore if there aren't these boundaries to push down and this friction to overcome. All right, I realize we're kind of at time. If I could somehow summarize and just get one last chance to listen to you about that before I assume this role of, amongst others, leading a small team which has some female team members. So some points that stuck out for me is, for heaven's sake, when a woman is introduced, it's about her technical capacity, her skills, and knowledge, and nothing else.
Right.
If a woman is being assertive, speaking up, being forthright in issuing a direction, it's not because she is excessively aggressive, mean-spirited, things like that.
Right.
No, she's just acting like a man would, and in that case, it would be okay. Those are the things that stuck out for me. Another one is that yours is a story of glory in terms of, you had a high-flying career around Hong Kong and Singapore and other, you mentioned the Greek Navy, did you? I mean, you've done all sorts of amazing things. So it's a story of incredible technical prowess, and that is not the domain of men exclusively. Those are useful things for me to have in the back of my mind as a leader. I wanted to just touch on, though, the honest remark that you made that actually no significant progress has occurred. And I'm paying attention to that because, for heaven's sake, of course, I want to put my shoulder to the wheel and actually be a part of a group of people who does make the change that you're saying still hasn't happened. So what else do I need to do?
Well, I want to reiterate that, anytime you're talking about a job, especially as you move up, it's about you're competing for that job against other people who want that job, right? So when you're looking to hire somebody as you move up, right, you remember that and realize that you need a well-balanced person, right? For most jobs, right? And I don't want to say it's male or female, but this balanced energy I'm going to keep going back to, right? You want somebody who can be aggressive but also compassionate, right? And I'm talking about in specific, I'm not talking about all roles. There's so many roles in a company, right? But when I'm talking about the front-facing roles, you want somebody who is balanced, and because unbalanced people cause strife in an organization. And I realize that. Like I've done stuff. I mean, in my aggressiveness, as you become one, for advice for women, as you model yourself after successful men, take a moment to go. And in fact, this happened to me at one point. I brought one of my direct reports back in. It was a man. And I apologized. I said I was behaving exactly like my boss. And I do not like how he behaves in that way. And I apologize. I'm like, I'm sorry I said that. I'm sorry I went down that. I should never have done that, right? You we model ourselves after people that we admire and respect, but nobody's perfect,
yeah.
Right? So identify those things in others. This is a great way to become a stronger person and a stronger leader. Identify those things you like and what you don't like and where you see people. Because when you're early in your career, you can see where people are getting hurt. You can see where the boss leaves the room and everybody there goes, is just devastated, right? Because he yelled at everybody or whatever, right? You see that. Pay attention and grow and learn from mistakes as your mistakes and their mistakes as much as anybody else's.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Okay. All right. I appreciate it.
And real quickly, another thing before I forget, sorry. And some of these things it's not necessarily the person. Again, remember this thing where I'm saying people started not giving me resumes of people that were probably qualified.
Yes.
Because they assumed that they wouldn't get approved, right? These things get embedded in your culture without you even realizing it. So you need to be on point looking for that all the time.
So don't let blindness creep in to talent.
Yeah. And it's why I don't like everybody's all about the metrics. This engineering thing that's come into, it's horrible in marketing, right? Like we're going to just measure, we're going to base our marketing on like engineering formula. That doesn't work. And it doesn't work with running a company. So if you measure, let's say you say, I'm going to just give people raises for the percentage of people that they brought in who actually got hired, then they're going to automatically help amplify your bias.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
That's also a backward-looking approach.
Yes.
And I suppose there's some intuition involved in gaining a sense of someone's capacity in the future and, you know, the unrealized potential that they might have been working on that hasn't resulted in any sales in the past quarter, but will in the next one.
Yeah, and it's not that easy, I'm telling you. And I have brought people up that were pushed back from Jack. And I went in there and made the case. I was willing to take that risk and made the case, and they got hired, and they're some of the best people that were at Esri, right? So but that stuff gets screened. It's so complicated. People are complicated, right? That's why numbers, right? Numbers aren't a way to manage a company. You can't manage a company purely on numbers. You know, it just, it doesn't work. Okay. Yeah. Sorry.
Okay. Thanks, Linda. I've had so much of your time over these, what has become 3 episodes.
Yeah.
I was expecting only one. So this just shows how much of a gift you are to our industry. And I'm so proud to have been able to assist in spreading the message a bit.
Yeah.
So
thank you.
It's a huge privilege.
Well, thank you for inviting me. It was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it.
Cool. I look forward to applying everything you've said.
Keep me posted on how it goes.
I will. Cheers, Linda.
Cheers.
In this election, we each face a question. What kind of country do we want to live in? There are some people who think we should be a country of chaos, of fear, of hate. But us, we choose something different. We choose freedom. Freedom, freedom, I can't move. Freedom, cut me loose. Freedom, freedom, where are you? 'Cause I need freedom too. The freedom not just to get by, but get ahead. The freedom to be safe from gun violence. The freedom to make decisions about your own body. We choose a future where no child lives in poverty. Where we can all afford health care. Where no one is above the law. We believe in the promise of America, and we're ready to fight for it. Because when we fight, we win. So join us. Go to KamalaHarris.com and let's get to work. I'ma keep running 'cause the winner don't quit on themselves.